Before 1993, Steven Spielberg's movies had a distinct look. But that all changed with Schindler's List and DP Janusz Kamiński.
The cinematographer has collaborated with Spielberg on all of his films for the last three decades, winning two Academy Awards in the process. What makes Kamiński's style so distinct? Why does one of the most celebrated directors of all time return to him again and again? This is the cinematography techniques of Janusz Kamiński. In previous episodes of this series, we've covered cinematographers like Roger Deakins and Hoyt van Hoytema. Subscribe to StudioBinder and turn on notifications to see which director of photography we cover next. Now, let's begin.
3, 2, 1, go!
Let's do it again!
Janusz Kamiński was born in Poland in 1959, and movies were a big part of his childhood.
For me, movies meant freedom, simply because I grew up in Eastern Europe, and we didn't really have the freedom to travel and experience the world. So for us, movies were the window to the world.
When he moved to the US in 1981, he quickly embedded himself in the film industry, attending AFI and then shooting B-movies for filmmaker Roger Corman. Since then, he's worked with a number of directors like Camerone Crowe, Judd Apatow, and James L. Brooks. But he is most well known for his collaborations with Steven Spielberg. Kamiński's work on the TV movie Wildflower first got Spielberg's attention. The director hired him for Class of 61, a TV movie he was producing, and then Schindler's List. As Spielberg's cinematographer, Kamiński learned how to work quickly.
You really have to move fast when you're making movies in Hollywood, especially with Steven. It's very important to have energy and momentum when you're making movies.
But for Kamiński, speed doesn't come at the cost of quality. Although his visual approach shifts depending on the project, there are certain elements which recur throughout his career, like heavy backlighting and gritty textures. These elements create a style that incorporates Spielberg's classical approach, while also giving it a more modern and edgy feel. Says Kamiński, Spielberg's work with other cinematographers was always sort of the same, because they were servicing his very traditional aesthetic. I'm trying to imprint each movie with my own style, and I hope to slowly change Steven's ideas about what's beautiful. This philosophy is evident in Kaminsky's approach to lighting. Kaminsky's lighting style is immediately recognizable. The cinematographer often opts for low-key lighting, which utilizes dark shadows and high contrast, right on the edge of underexposing.
The magic happens when you're like, man, you're about to fall off the cliff because, you know, you're just balancing yourself. So usually it's either too dark or it's too bright, where you just almost don't see the image. That's when it's beautiful.
Kaminsky's calling card is strong backlight. He explains, I love backlight, not just for the sake of glamorizing the subject, but because the direction of the light can represent storytelling. I don't do backlights and then also add key lights and all these things. If I do backlight, I want to see that backlight. To fully appreciate how much this lighting approach affects the aesthetic of Spielberg's films, one can look at the difference between Jurassic Park and The Lost World. Jurassic Park, which was shot by DP Dean Cundey, utilizes much more high-key lighting, emphasizing the majesty of the dinosaurs and imbuing the film with a lighter tone. The Lost World, meanwhile, has all of Kaminsky's trademarks. Spielberg noted, from a lighting standpoint, we took a sketchier approach. On Jurassic Park, we let the dinosaurs reflect more light. But on this movie, we let them absorb more light. Kaminsky explained that this style informed the film's tone,
making it more moody.
Less about the wonder of the dinosaurs and more about the danger.
Hang on, this is gonna be bad.
To heighten the contrast, Kamiński shot on Eastman Kodak Vision 5293 film stock, which is contrasty without being grainy. Kamiński also made heavy use of backlight in the film. The cinematographer wanted direct light sources that could also light whole dinosaurs, so he decided to use sun arcs, rare light fixtures which were used as searchlights in World War II. The arcs have a mirror directly behind the bulb that makes them highly directional and powerful. The result is a powerful and visible backlight worthy of a dinosaur. Kamiński's lighting isn't always so stylized. For The Post, the cinematographer wanted to emulate reality, meaning much of the lighting would need to simulate a fluorescent workplace. Kamiński put film lights into the newsroom ceiling so that the lighting would still be overhead but could be more controlled. He would then occasionally place soft light sources outside the frame. But because there is so much camera movement, this often wasn't possible. The hyper-realism removes any romanticism from the aesthetic and maintains a slightly grittier feel.
The White House has been lying about the Vietnam War for 30 years. It's Truman and Eisenhower and Jack, LBJ lying about Vietnam. And you think that's one story? Let's do our jobs.
For Kamiński, lighting helps tell the story. On Amistad, the DP used fey lights bounced off muslin with a half-soft frost diffusion frame, which created soft light that was true to the environment while still being directional. These lights created harsh shadows that emphasized the dark mood of the film. He explains, "The characters were suffering from cold and starvation, and I felt that the lighting should support that storyline." Since the mid-90s, Spielberg has often chosen to tell stories that are darker and more brutal than the stories which characterized his early career. Janusz Kamiński's approach to lighting is crucial to these films, lending them a grittier aesthetic fitting for their subject matter. The same could be said of Kamiński's use of color. Color in Kamiński's cinematography is used to subtly heighten the mood of a given scene. Uplifting scenes are often a bit more vibrant, while intense and downtrodden sequences are far less saturated. Of course, his first film with Spielberg was mostly black and white. The two decided on complete desaturation for Schindler's List in order to give gravity to the subject matter, while also transporting the audience back to the 1930s and 40s. Kamiński explains, "The newsreel quality of the black and white seemed to fade the barriers of time, making the footage feel like an ongoing horror that I was witnessing firsthand." But shooting black and white doesn't mean color is no longer a consideration. First, Kamiński needed to choose how to capture the black and white footage. The decision was between desaturating the film in post or shooting on native black and white stock. The cinematographer shot tests with Kodak color 5247 and 5296, and black and white 5231 and 5222. He noticed that the desaturated color footage had a slight blue tint and opted for the black and white stock. Kamiński also ran extensive tests to see how different makeup and costume colors appear on the black and white stock. He discovered that tone was the key. In color film, green and blue have distinct differences, but in black and white, they read the same. This is because they have the same tone, but this is not the case in red and blue. The color red is not lighter than blue, but red stands out more in black and white because the tone is brighter. For this reason, tones became more important than colors.
The list is an absolute good. The list is life. All around its margins lies the gulf.
For Minority Report, Kamiński wanted to build a futuristic color palette that diverged from the dominant Blade Runner-esque look most sci-fi films were emulating at the time.
It's a near future film, so you want to create aesthetics that are different from what we used to, but not too eccentric so people cannot identify.
The cinematographer supplemented the gray with touches of blue. He notes that blue light on people makes them seem lonely and alienated.
Look, put the camera down, or you're not getting anything tonight.
As such, Kamiński's visual palette was pulling from noirs as much as it was from science fiction. Munich, meanwhile, uses different colors to quickly establish new locations, a helpful tool in a film which travels the globe. Beirut is a blue-green. Rome is warmer. Nicosia is a yellow-green. Paris is desaturated. Color in the film also informs the characters. As our characters go to Europe and start to comprehend the weight of their actions, the image becomes grittier, bluer, grainier. The cinematographer achieved these color palettes primarily through choices in film stock. He shot different locations on different stocks, alternating between various Kodak stocks, which are a bit more saturated, and Fuji stocks, which are more subdued. Keen attention to color means close collaboration with the art department. On Lincoln, longtime Spielberg production designer Rick Carter faithfully recreated famous scenes from American history. Kamiński, meanwhile, needed to make sure some of the vivid coloring of the true-to-life sets didn't overwhelm the viewer's eye. He explains his approach in the deathbed scene. The colors on set were extremely bright. I had to control the amount of information in the frame by reducing the amount of light hitting the walls. I used different color effects, like the bluish light, to eliminate some of that color, because otherwise it would start looking too fake. The time of year also affected the color palette of Lincoln.
We are in winter light, right? So the winter light by definition is a little bit cooler, not as colorful. I am using sunlight, so you would think sunlight would be warm, but yet, well, I wanted that sunlight to be slightly white, you know, simply because it just felt right.
This cool, desaturated color palette informs the mood of the film, which depicts a dire time in U.S. history.
I've never seen the like of it before, what I've seen today.
Kamiński's use of color enhances the desired emotion of a scene, just like his unique choices of equipment. Kamiński is very particular when it comes to the equipment he uses on a given movie. He always does extensive screen tests before a shoot to make sure his choices are the right ones for the project. And his choices are not always the obvious ones. Where some cinematographers may opt for the highest fidelity image they can get, Kamiński relishes the imperfections of equipment, using them to give his films a rough and tactile quality. This is partially why the director of photography refuses to shoot on digital. He claims that digital images are so crispy, so unforgiving. Perhaps Kamiński's most daring use of camera imperfections can be seen in Saving Private Ryan. The cinematographer wanted to emulate the footage of the 1940s, so he used a vintage set of ultra-speed lenses and removed their protective coatings to further deteriorate the image. Removing the protective coating made the image much flatter, so he used a Technicolor ENR process to increase the contrast. Removing the coating also made the light more diffused in the lens, adding haze to the image while still maintaining sharpness. On top of this, the DP purposely mismatched lenses on the multiple cameras covering the D-Day sequence, making the spectacle feel more chaotic. Kamiński also made the shutter speed out of sync, which creates a vertical streaking effect, further degrading the image. All these decisions were made with one goal, according to Kamiński. It's a war movie, and it's supposed to feel realistic to the audience. The lenses were dirty. I did some tests, and what we learned was very beneficial for the storytelling.
Quite a view.
On Indiana Jones and the Crystal Skull, Kamiński wanted to achieve a very different look, while still transporting the audience to a bygone era.
Hey, I knocked. You guys got a pull.
The cinematographer primarily shot on Ariflex cameras with Panavision anamorphic lenses, letting him capture the action in epic wide shots. To evoke a feeling of nostalgia, Kamiński softened the footage with Schneider Classic Soft filters, giving the film a glossy, classical Hollywood aesthetic. On the much smaller scale, the diving bell and the butterfly, Kamiński experimented with a swing and shift lens, which gives a cinematographer near total control over what is and isn't in focus in a given shot.
It's a very, very specific lens where you can set the lens through a system of bellows that the whole image is sharp or just a little portion.
The use of the swing shift in Diving Bell allowed for a level of visual dynamism, especially important for a movie which tells much of its story from the point of view of a character in a pseudo-coma.
Mais les techniques de réanimation ont fait tellement de progrès que nous sommes maintenant on peut essayer de maintenir, enfin, on peut prolonger la vie.
Ça c'est la vie. Ça c'est la vie.
Prolonger la vie. Voilà.
Kamiński went on to use the lens for Bridge of Spies while shooting in anamorphic. Here, however, he wanted it to be more subtle, simply softening the edges of the frame. Sometimes, imperfections are crucial to a film story.
I had to crash it a whole lot of times, but the train never got hurt.
Really?
For The Fabelmans, Kamiński was tasked with recreating Spielberg's 8mm home movies. Because 8mm film is now very rare, Kamiński shot the footage in 16mm and then deteriorated the image in post.
Movies are dreams, doll, that you never forget. You just wait and see. When it's over, you're gonna have the biggest, sloppiest smile on your face.
God, you're letting us in.
Janusz Kamiński's distinct cinematic vision has made him one of the most celebrated working cinematographers. His deliberate approach to lighting, color, and equipment creates unforgettable images filled with unconventional beauty. For more on the cinematographer, check out the StudioBinder blog where we ranked his films and put together a mood board of his best shots. Start planning your next cinematic images with StudioBinder's storyboard software. And make sure to subscribe and click the bell to stay up to date on all things filmmaking. Until next time, shoot every shot like Spielberg is watching, because he just might be.
I learn actually more from young filmmakers today than I do from some of the older filmmakers that made movies 80, 90, 60 years ago.